you kindly introduce yourself?
We have got three friends in the panel today.
Yes.
The gentleman on my right is well known to Mr. Saeed Ahmad Jones.
Of course,
I know very well. Ahmadi brother for so many years, mashallah. And then is our brother from Ghana, Mr. Thomas Odempton.
Odempton.
Yes, he is working in Euro consultancy in Tooting area.
Right.
And
Euro consultancy.
Yes.
Is it a British government service or what?
Would you kindly explain yourself?
Is it a company, independent concern? I don't know that.
Yeah. Okay, Euro consultancy is a partnership between consultants in England and Brussels and the European states who have come together to share ideas of how to get involved with the emerging market, the single euro.
But who is organizing this? Who are the principals of this?
South Thames College in London.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Thompson College.
Yes.
So it's a private college, isn't it?
No, it's organized by the partly by the government and partly by the
European. That is why what I asked in the beginning, you know. What I wanted to understand is Euro consultancy is a title which perhaps will have some involvement with the government at some stage.
Yes.
Yes.
Right.
It is.
And how long have you been in England?
Well, I've been here for about 10 years now.
For 10 years?
Yes. In fact, more than 10 years.
Right.
Yeah.
And your profession before you came?
My profession was working with the Attorney General's office.
Attorney General?
Yes, in Ghana.
In Ghana?
Yes.
Right, right.
But since I've been here, I've been working as a financial consultant.
That's great. That's
before joining Euro Consultants.
Good. Please?
Yes. And next is Mr. Rustam Mini Ahmetov. He comes from Kazan.
From Kazan?
Yes.
Right.
That's a republic.
Yes, yes, of course I know.
It belongs to Russia still yet.
I know Kazan very well. You know, we have many. We have a regular mission in Kazan.
Yes.
And we have many friends from Kazan, in fact, who have become Ahmadis and others who have not yet, but they hold very intimate relations with us. So let's start.
Yes, yes, please.
So on a little bit of a personal note, first of all, when you lead us in prayer, do you pre-plan what surah to recite after Al-Fatiha, or is it left to divine guidance?
Well, I don't know what you mean by divine guidance. If it is what you have in mind is its particular guidance at the time of my praying, that you should do this or that, this is not the case at all. But if you submit to God, then everything you do is sort of under the canopy of God, and if that is what you refer to as divine guidance, then everything is under divine guidance, of course. But my, I have a general plan in mind, both in those prayers which in which surahs are recited, and both in which they are not recited. So, ever since I became a Khalifa, I have stuck to that plan. And I keep changing them, some according to the days, and some shifting at a different pace, so that they are not repeated on each day.
Yes.
That you might have noticed.
Yes, yes.
So similarly, there are certain prayers which I prefer to recite during the silent prayers, and in that the principle that guides me is that generally the silent prayers are expected to be shorter in duration, so those who pray behind, I owe them this, that I choose shorter surahs rather than the longer ones.
Yes.
Right?
Thank you.
Please.
Your Holiness, what I want to know is that how can the advancement in biotechnology transform the development prospects of the third world without having adverse effects on the environment and the health of people?
You have asked a very complex question, in which, in fact, two or three questions are already incorporated. The transfer of technology is one important thing from the first world to the third world. That transfer is not in our control and command, because those who own a high degree of technology, it is for them to decide how much of this to be shared with the third world. And some of that simmers through automatically by natural process. Because more people get advanced, more services are needed for them at low basis. And those technologies which belong to the low basis begin to lose their value with the passage of time. Because second, third, fourth stories are built on top of them and they become commonplace. So these technologies automatically simmer through to the third world and they continue to lag behind. But as far as the progress, as far as the spearhead is concerned, the spearhead of progress is kept under very strict lock and key state, where no one is permitted to leak the technology to the so-called outsiders. And for that, they keep an eye on the employment policy as well. They would not permit any third world country immigrant, even if he has been given a national status, to be raised to a level of involvement in industry where he would be able to not steal, but able to learn a secret which in itself could work elsewhere. Now what I'm saying is, I'm choosing the words very carefully. What I have in mind is, in itself is the important question. I know some very intelligent and bright students from the third world, like Ghana, Pakistan, India, are given important positions. But those positions are such as cannot work in themselves. You know, whatever they learn there, it cannot suffice by itself to transfer any technological possibility across. Because this possibility can only develop in groups of technologies, not in single technologies. So when you see is here and there some Asians rising to a very high degree in some industry, it is only done when they are exceptionally intelligent people, when they have learned something by themselves during their researches here, and as long as they are employed, the benefit will transfer from them to the nation, the host nation. And no way could they take something out of this nation and push it across the national barrier to their original nation, original country, I should say. So this is a very well organized thing which is not written. It's traditional. And it runs in every country. I keep receiving reports from Ahmadis who are exceptionally intelligent and who have received gold medals in this and that study, that when they seek employment in America, for instance, they can reach up to a certain level, and after that it's just barred. They don't want his services. But when the services are required, they are required for specific tasks in specific conditions. So that is why I have been warning Africa during my tours, particularly in Ghana. You know, I had long discussions with the policy makers, that you're wasting your money, your resources, without any purpose on higher education. because you have a stomach, and that stomach can digest only certain type of food. Whatever extra potent food you prepare, that cannot be digested by your stomach. It has no place and no corresponding glandular setup to digest it. So what happens is, you spend a lot of money on raising the standard of education in your country beyond the stage where you could consume whatever you produce yourself. So there is a constant rift. All such students go abroad, never to return. If they return, they find no employment for them, no occupation, no use. So you have to change your policy to a degree where it suits your country and raise the base, the entire base of education, to a degree that there is more and more demand of intellect within the country, and they can be given employment not only for the benefit of the country but for their own benefit as well. So there is an equation which has to be brought into view before we chalk out a policy. This is not a part of the question you asked, but this is a part of the answer which must be given along with the question raised. So first of all, I told you that the third world will never willingly part with technology which they have gained through their own labor, and for centuries they have been working on scientific pursuits, and whatever is the outcome is their wealth. Why should they part with it without any compulsion? We must learn the ways and means to learn the same things either directly or through some other clever devices. Japan, for instance, broke the barriers by employing a very clever and intelligent policy right from the beginning. You see, instead of raising their standard of living on foreign goods, they started working hard to imitate things which were made in the foreign countries. And it was just an imitation. In every development of Japanese industry or technology, you will find the journey beginning with imitations. Then in the process, they began to learn a few tricks here and there. Then they gained confidence. They imitated not just the form, but also penetrated deeper. And as such, whenever they sent students to America or England or other European countries, they were sent with a purpose to learn something and return. Only such Japanese students still are working abroad, like in America, etc., who are involved in such areas where Japan has no usage. Theoretical physics, etc., you know, all these things. And the Japanese are working there, but wherever they are working, they keep on passing their information back to the country. And that information is somehow utilized, and first of all, it is distributed to the right places. And I have studied some cases, actual cases, of how Japanese scientists are working hand in hand with their counterparts in America, and it is surprising how they continue to benefit from whatever they gain in any other country, like particularly in America, because it is a consciously designed plan. While scientists from Pakistan, scientists from India, from Bangladesh, from Ghana, from Nigeria lose their identity when they go over to other countries, and there is no system to attract them back to their own country. Now, the problem is manifold. It is not just a single simple problem. It is many-sided. You know, I have already raised the question of false standards of living imported from abroad, east or west, whatever it is. But third world countries have this impatience to live more luxuriously in shortest possible time. Now, this has been inbred into them by the traditions. Previously, the traditions began with as a result of strict, well chalked out colonial policies. It was decided and immaculately acted upon, implemented, that we must raise the standard of living of the colonies, or our industries and trade will find no customers anywhere. So the foreign rule was not just for the pleasure of ruling. It never was. It was only to raise the national economic standard at the cost of certain other countries. So the rule was only to organize their economy, their way of life, to a degree, to in a manner, that they will remain dependent on the produce of the country which is ruling them. So tariff rules, regulations were all carved out to serve this purpose. And this is what I have been trying to remind all African countries where I visited. For God's sake, don't forget that your standard of life is a false standard of life, and it is Pakistan being no exception. So it's not just a criticism directed at one group of countries. I'm talking in general of the third world countries. I said you have carved, for instance, Ghana, where I met the ministers at the highest level. I told them you have carved a small Ghana out of a big Ghana. The larger Ghana lives at the grassroots level of existence, traditional way of life. And it is becoming less properly fed than before, because most of the wealth of the country is drawn by that smaller Ghana in size, which is so high in position. And so that most of the economy is used to support that small Ghana raised at a much higher level, and it has to be kept at that higher level at the cost of the rest of the Ghana. So because whatever they are accustomed to now, it is not the fruit of their own trees. It is the fruit of trees which grow either in Europe or in America or in Canada, you know, these places, or in Germany in particular for cars and things. So they are drugged in a way that they never realize that this is worse than drugging, with the result that these people want more wealth for their support. And the fruits of your own country, the raw material which you produce, is exported to gain the finished goods. And the result is that you become poorer and poorer. The industry which you import from foreign countries, that industry is a burden on your economy. It's never a support to your economy. I can prove it with specific references to some cases. In Ghana, for instance, textile industry was imported from Germany along with the German experts to run it, because the know-how to how to run the industry was not enough. So these textile mills, one I have in mind in particular, there was a German mill which was of the highest class, in that case, the Germans did not cheat the Ghanaians in any way. It was the most advanced textile mill which they were also working in Germany. So they exported it to Japan along with their technicians, Ghana along with their technicians. But what happened? The terms, first of all, for 5 years there will be no repayment. After the five years, the repayment begins along with the interest which is accumulated. And by 5 years, the way this industry is handled by the lower staff, more likely than not, this industry would have turned into junk. But it happened faster than that and in a different way. It happened because in the meantime, in Ghana, the labor unions had become very powerful, and the labor had become also very lazy, and they became unruly. The result was that these German masters who were running the factory, although they were technicians of the top class, but they were still there in a minority. The most of the laborers were the Ghanaians, and they would not cooperate. They started striking and this and that. So it was the Germans who got fed up, because they are very different type of people. You know, they can't cope with similar situations at all like the British can. They know in many ways. You know, they have a much longer experience of India and Pakistan, now India and other colonies. So the Germans got fed up until the machinery began to come to stand still, one after the other. Half of the mill had become dead before the end of the 5 years period.
Which saved the Ghanaians.
Yes. And then the left said, let us go, for God's sake. When I sent my representative to have an investigation into the affairs of this industry, I had heard about, only then the details came. It was after my visit to Ghana. So I sent an expert from Pakistan, who is an expert of very high quality, among the very top ones, scientists who know this textile industry, who is working at the highest level in the industry everywhere in Pakistan. So he went and he studied everything and sent me the report that although the cotton produced in Ghana is second to none in the world, second to no country in the world, and it's better than Egypt, it's equal to the highest class cotton produced in America. But there is no room, no possibility, no wisdom in trying to have a cotton industry in Ghana, textile industry in Ghana, because of these factors. So although that factory was already on sale, and some people were very excited that an excellent factory is on sale, he advised me to keep my hands off this. So this is again a problem. The corruption in the third world countries is of a very different nature from the corruption in the first world countries. The corruption in the first world countries is penetrating the highest level of decision making, and they can run away with whatever money they can, even at the national cost within their country or during international dealings, but not at the cost of the quality of the work or the cost of the quality of the industry itself. They never do it. If they do it, that is something which will never be forgiven. Severest punishment will be awarded to them if they are caught doing this. But in other things, no special attention is drawn towards that. If such cases come up automatically, then they are handled, otherwise everybody knows what's happening. You know? But in our country, it is always at the cost of national interest. Every time. The negotiators sell the interest of our countries during negotiations with the foreign countries. So in that case, they corrupt them at the cost of their own country. And the benefit draws from, begins to flow from them to the advanced countries. Similarly, is the case of trades. They employ their agents, distributors, etc. And it is those agents and distributors who are always highly connected. Not, if not always, most often. They have some connections with the army, with the civil, bureaucracy, etc., etc. So why this? Because then they know that they will be of some benefit, whereby some flaws in the contract will not be noticed, will not be taken note of. And they will always be to the advantage of the richer country. In trade, in all other negotiations which relate to economy, the sum, the final result is this. Now, to come to the end of this this observation, the final result is always this, that the money flows from the poorer country to the richer countries. There is no way can you change it. The consciousness is not yet born. The moral level has sunk so low that right from top to bottom, everybody is immoral and corrupt at the cost of its own people, his own people or their own people. See? So, I hope all the necessary aspects of your questions have been dealt with.
Well done.
Right? Thank you.
It's good. Thank you.
Please.
Your Holiness, I would like to know why, if compared with another countries, in Muslim countries, you're allowed to have you're allowed to have more than one wife.
Yes. Where is it not allowed? Tell me. Show me a single country where it is not allowed to have more than one wife. Can you quote a single country in the world?
No, I don't know.
Huh? Do you think
in England
more than one wife is not allowed in England?
I think so.
No, not at all. You can keep any number of wives here. Only you don't have to call them wives.
Yes, I mean officially.
In America, you know, during the research into some spread of some violent diseases, very, very dangerous and deadly diseases, sex-related diseases, they came to learn that there are some husbands, unmarried husbands, who have had relations with more than 100 wives. Again, unmarried wives. And also married wives. To unmarried husbands, you know. So this is a joke when they turn to Islam and object against permission. It's a matter of laughter. Not, it doesn't require a serious answer at all. You understand?
Yes, yes.
What they are against is order and legality. They don't like that. Yes, please.
Thanks, sir. In the book Gardens of the Righteous, Nawas ibn Saman.
Nawas ibn Saman, yes.
Relates that the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, mentioned the signs of the last day and of the Antichrist. And in it, I'd like to just quote one sentence. Allah the Exalted will raise the Messiah, son of Mary, who will arrive close to a white minaret in the east of Damascus, wearing two saffron-coloured garments, his hands resting on the wings of two angels. End of the sentence. Now, if this sentence is purely symbolic, why did the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, have a white minaret built?
First of all, it is not properly translated. It is never said that close to the minaret, in the Minaret al-Bayda are the words, and some have translated upon that Manara, or some have translated close to that Manara. But upon translation is wrong anyway, because it can only be right if the whole sentence is translated differently. In the Banarata Sharqiya Damashq, two things are said, in the Manara, upon or close to the Manara, or and east of Damascus. So some translate it as east of Damascus relating to Manara, so which means that the Manara will be situated east of Damascus. And those who translate Inda as close to Manara, they say he would be close to Manara on the eastern side, but not on the Manara. But the problem is that if you translate it like that, not upon the Manara, then there are other traditions which lose relevance at all altogether. Because all the ulama, if not all, a large number of ulama believe that in other ahadith which are related to the subject, the scenario which is built is this, that the Messiah would descend upon the Manara, not around or near the Manara. So if that is so, then the Manara has to be in the east, and there is no word indicating its nearness to Damascus. Then all that is said is it would be in the east of Damascus. How much east is not related there. The second proof they offer of this interpretation being correct is that it is also said that the Masih, when he descends upon the Manara will be without a staircase. And that Manara, where he would descend, having no staircase, it will require ulama to run towards the Manara with their stairs or ladders, and for the Messiah to descend from those ladders. Now, first of all, if you contemplate on this, it becomes obviously that it cannot be taken literally. It's impossible to take this prediction literally, because the Messiah who descends resting his hands on the two angels from the fourth heaven is deposited there so close to earth and he can't jump down. And the angels desert him and return to heaven without depositing him upon the earth. So he rests for the ulama. This positively proves that all the message is symbolic. And the symbolism used here has been explained by Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam. He says, white, the minaret is a thing which is seen from far and wide. The taller the minaret is, the more it will be observed from a distance. Yes. So this shows that the Messiah would come, but he will not disappear to insignificance when he comes to the world. It will be the Manara, depositing on the Manara means his descent from heaven will not be observed, because people who come from God, their descent from heaven is never observed. But they are made to be known the world over, if Allah so desires. And the whiteness is a symbol of powerful arguments and truth. So he'll come stationed on truth,
yes,
and powerful luminous arguments, and his message would reach far and wide. This would happen in east of Damascus. You see? Now, if you study geographically, Qadian happens to be exactly on the east of Damascus. So Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam did not build the Manara to the finish during his lifetime. So there was no attempt by him to deceive the public, because he wrote a book on this subject and he knew better than any of the ulama that the menara was not little. But he said sometimes legends and stories and things develop around realities. Sometimes realities are built to indicate symbols. And to memorize the symbolic messages. Like for instance, in the case of Ashabul Kahf, the people of the cave, when they came out of it and when the whole situation was transformed, it was discussed what would be the symbol for their great sacrifices. Now that symbol was, although metaphoric, but it was given a material shape of a minaret or a mosque. So after the discussion, they said, let's build a mosque. Now, there was no mosque before to indicate that that would be built on the mouth of the caves of the righteous people. But mosque was built later on to indicate that it was here that God-fearing believers in the unity of God, people who were persecuted and prosecuted on the surface of earth, who had to seek shelter into the caves, under the caves. When they came out, they came out here, they emerged here. And from then on, their life was transformed upon earth, and then they spread the message far and wide. A mosque became the symbol. So Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam did not begin the building of minaret, he only began to prove that this is the minaret on whom he had descended, or by whom he had descended. Not at all. What he said was that he has come on that minaret of significance. I mean, on that minaret, the significance of which he had described. So to create a material symbol of this event, he has decided to build a white minaret.
I see.
See?
This is what I was having trouble with, because I've understood from previous sermons that you've given the two saffron garments were related to the two illnesses, and I knew that he didn't literally wear them,
never,
so
never
I was
did.
Having trouble with this.
Quite right. Now you know this, he has explained it in,
yes,
in detail, in depth, the significance and the material part of building the minaret, why.
Mm.
So, and again, you know, as I told you, the minaret was started in his lifetime, but it was,
yes,
completed much later,
mm,
in the lifetime of Hazrat Khalifa bin Sayyawal.
The second.
Completed.
Yes.
In which year?
1915.
Because in 1914, Hazrat Khalifa bin Sayyawal, the first caliph, died.
Yes.
So it must have been completed in 15. Huh?
Yes.
Right. Or 16, maybe?
15, yes. Right. Started in 1903.
Okay.
Thank you.
Please.
Your Holiness, I've always wondered what is the significance and meanings in the process of praying with the Muslims when they bow down and they kneel and they always look up to Mecca,
right,
as opposed to other.
First of all, when in prayer, they never even dream of Mecca. It is just a direction fixed by God to, as a symbol of the universal unity of Muslims. Because if they were permitted to face in diverse directions individually, then that unity which was meant to be built around Khana Kaaba, the house of God, it is said, to create a sort of unity among those who believed in unity, to create a unity among those who worshipped unity, not Khana Kaaba. A direction had to be fixed. And the Holy Quran has spoken on that very clearly. It says, wherever you are in the world, face towards Kaaba, but God is everywhere. Anama tawallu fa thamma wajhullah, Remember, whichever way you turn, you'll find the face of Allah. So this is not Allah that you are directing. The purpose is different. The purpose is to give you a unity. And the second thing is that to bow and to prostrate and to stand and to sit are all the postures which have been used by different religions differently, severally, and sometimes individually, sometimes partly in groups, but never in totality. In nowhere will you find any religion which combines all these postures, but nowhere will you find any religion which does not have at least one of these postures during their worship. Hindus do it standing, you know, like this, and the Christians kneel down, and some Buddhists sit and contemplate, and many prostrate. So all these postures combined in the prayer of the Muslims is indicative of the universal religion. A religion has come which would not be foreign to any religion of the world, and they will find familiar things and habits in its teachings belonging to different religions, different people, different countries. So that is the overall significance of these different postures. But that is superficial significance. There is deep underlying significance which requires much longer discussion, which unfortunately for which we do not have time now. Hazrat Masih Maud has written volumes over the significance of standing like this, bowing, prostrating. But one small illustration can be given in this time. Whatever you recite during these different postures, it is related to that posture. For instance, when you prostrate, then you are at the humblest position before God. Your head is touching the soil, the earth. You can't dig into it, of course, but that is the lowest you can go. And the words you recite is Subhana Rabbi al-Ala, Subhana Rabbi al-Ala, Subhana Rabbi al-Ala. Holy is He, free from all blemish, the one who is the loftiest, the loftiest, the loftiest. So when you are the lowliest, when you have, you know, rubbed your forehead with the soil, rubbing your forehead with the soil, then the message is, if you want to reach the loftiest in relation to Him, you should adopt the humblest attitude. And your loftiness depends on how low you fall to your to God, to your Creator. The lower your inner prostration is. Now here, because its significance, I'm talking now inner prostration, not the bodily prostration. Lower your inner prostration to Him is, more humble you grow in the course of your worship to your Lord, the loftier will be your station in His sight. Now this is fully supported. I mean, this interpretation is not one which I am attributing to the Holy Quran because I want to laud its teachings. This is exactly supported by Hadith, a tradition of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said that according to this Hadith Qudsi, which is based on a revelation of God, Allah told him that when My servant exercises humility, I send a chain from heaven who wraps him up and lifts him to the seventh heaven. Now the chain indicates different stages, different links. And when you read this hadith in totality, the message delivered is very clear that if you want to rise in the sight of Allah, lower yourself in your own sight in relation to Allah, then heaven would see to it that your station is lifted. Seventh heaven is the last, the maximum you can reach. So if your prostration, that is inner prostration, is genuine and sincere, and it is of course sincere and genuine, but it reaches a certain stage and not beyond, then maybe that chain leaves you at the first heaven and no more. But if it is complete where you can reach, your limit of prostration cannot be reached just by saying, I submit to God. Because there are trials in life, every moment of one's life, where that prostration is tested. So if you are tested to the maximum of your capacity, then seventh heaven is your ultimate goal. So the significance of this prayer is very deep and very well connected. And once you understand, you begin to fall in love with this complex but very well organized and meaningful system of Muslim worship. Thank you. Yes, please.
Yes, Your Holiness, I would like to know why in a Muslim country not allowed to eat the pork.
Oh, all right. But you are asking, you're beginning the question in the wrong place. First of all, this question should have been addressed to the Jews, because they are the first in the history of religion to have forbidden the eating of pork so strictly that even today, in this world of promiscuity, there are many Jews who still abstain from eating pork, a large number of them in fact. So this question should begin with them. Secondly, the question should be addressed to the Christians. Why do you eat pork? Because nowhere in the New Testament the Christians have been permitted by Jesus Christ to eat pork. So that injunction of the book continues to be good and in operation. It has never been invalidated by Jesus Christ. So why should they eat pork? So by the time you have reached the Muslims, you should have understood the significance. The fact is, there are two main things which should be borne in mind. Number one, Allah reminds you that everything which He has created, which to whom He has given life, should be respected, and life cannot be taken but with Allah's permission. So all the healthy edible things, if He has permitted you to eat, how would He know, or how can it be proved that you are eating with His permission? Unless there is always a test available. One of the edible things, from one of the edible things, permission is withdrawn. And then your submission to God is tested. That is put to test, all right. If you say you are eating fish and you are eating chicken and eating beef and mutton, etc., etc., because it is permitted, then pork is not permitted. So the proprietor, the ultimate master, has the right, the loyalties of his subjects. So if nothing else is understood, the significance of this test is very obvious and it should be understood. And the religion begins with such a thing. Eat of the fruit of gardens, of all trees, wherever you go. But don't eat the fruit of this forbidden tree. You see, the whole Jannah is left open for you to enjoy, but not that tree. So this significance runs through all religions in different forms. And it is not essential for God to explain to you why. If you believe in Him, only then you will follow. Only then you will follow Him and His religious instructions. So if the journey begins with belief, then such questions are not asked in detail, because the significance is then in obedience. And it's sufficient significance, which is a natural outcome of belief. If you accept a government to be genuinely sovereign, then that sovereign government has to be obeyed. And then you don't have to understand every legislation, every law and rule of the country to obey it. But you have to obey, whether you, even if you disagree. So that is the first part. And the second part is that pork is forbidden. I understand, although it's not detailed, mentioned in any detail, I believe that the swine, the pig, has two exceptional traits in him, exceptional habits, which are shared to a degree by some animals, but some are one of the habits at least, which we find not shared by others, and so one of the ugliest habits. For instance, I'm talking of this second one, those animals who are flesh eaters, like beasts of the jungle, etc., even despite the fact that they are flesh eaters, they don't eat the flesh of their own sort when it dies. You will never hear of lions eating the flesh of lions. They will starve in hunger, never eat the flesh of dead or live lions. The wolves, supposed to be the most ferocious animals, they don't eat each other up. They will die in pain and suffering. They will become skeletons while they live. But they would never dream of attacking their own brothers and eating their flesh. Now, this is a strange animal. It is largely vegetarian. But when a pig dies, it would eat its flesh. A pig would eat the flesh of its own little ones. Now, this is a very, very obnoxious thing which stands out. And according to the to my understanding, there are certain habits which have their imprint on the flesh and blood of the animals. They have some causative factor lying there somewhere. So if such factors could be transferred through consumption of their flesh, so this could be one. You become sort of man-eaters. When you eat pigs, you don't care for the poor human beings who are like you, who belong to the same species. You can draw their blood and transfer it to blood transfusion to the richer people without the slightest, you know, pang of conscience. Now, it does not mean that you actually begin to eat, but this callousness toward the human problems can develop. If Africa is dying of hunger and other countries are rich enough to support them, to at least somehow survive that very critical period, they would not, for other reasons, economic reasons, other problems, that if we dumped our extra meat or butter into Africa, any country of Africa, then the economy here will be imbalanced. I don't want to go into detail, but this is exactly the debate which I heard during this period, that they have some purpose of this, to keep it mounting, kept here. And America had its own limitations in helping Abyssinia. During those days of very severe drought and consequent famine, the country had run dry of its food and water, etc. And America would not help because it was a communist country. The communists could not help because they did not have extra food to transport there. Europe would not help because they said that the they had two excuses instead. They said the transportation is difficult and the cost of sending food wherever it's needed would be very high. So it was permitted to die and starve to death. These are the considerations which do creep into human calculations and attitudes. But I'm talking of the flesh of swine. What I mean to say is you don't find cannibalism develop into in human beings among the flesh eaters, among the swine eaters, but carelessness to human problems and relationship is at least witnessed. Somebody may say it's because of different causes, but one may also say, because this is only an area of judging and guessing what might have been the significance. So I'm just putting forward a guess. I may be right, may be wrong, but my being right cannot be ruled out, you see. The second thing is homosexuality. Homosexuality is one habit which runs wild in this animal. Of all the animals, this stands out in this habit of being homosexual. And those countries where pig eating is general, I mean it's permitted, there you find least objection against homosexuality. Until a time reaches when openly one can say they should be given equal rights in the army, in the church, and here and there, and there is no harm. So when they say there is no harm, this is the harm done to them. That they see no harm in a habit which is contradiction of nature and evolution. Sex developed for a purpose and with a purpose. And purposeless enjoyment from sex is not the design of nature. They are even going, the scientists who are homosexuals, you know, they are delving deeper into the genes and characters and trying to prove that it is genetic. Why it is not genetic in certain societies belonging to certain other religions? Why this genetic onslaught on your society alone? So this is all just mere excuses to support a certain tendency which has become grown out of their control now. And why Sodom and Gomorrah, why were they destroyed? What was the message? The obvious message was that sex was provided to human beings or all animals for the survival of the species. If you use it only for the concomitant pleasure, then you deny the need for the survival practically, and you misuse a provision by nature, and Allah will not let it go unpunished, you know, that sort of thing. It happened in the case of Sodom and Gomorrah, but it doesn't seem to happen now. But it is happening, people don't see. The sex-related diseases which have become fatal are now throwing shadows over nations which has not yet to shower death upon them. has yet started to shower death upon them, because the ultimate result of the hidden potential HIV positive cases lingers on even for 9 years. And once the suitable climate is available, which Allah knows how it will be done, then it can become so deadly a disease, such a deadly a punishment for mankind as a whole, that even nations will die almost entirely. Like Uganda is already being we have MD doctors working there, and we know this is right, that in certain areas of Uganda they call it slim. The medical opinion is that almost everybody is now HIV positive, and it's only a matter of time that you'll hear the whole area being completely wiped out of humans. So this is not without any significance, this thing. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And I think it's time, isn't it? How do you know? All right, time is over.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Thanks. For coming, and it's a pleasure meeting you.
MTA International, reaching the corners of the earth.